Have you ever written a thank you note to someone or received one? Paul wrote Philippians as a great big thank you note. When he wrote this letter, he was in prison. Why was he in prison? For preaching the gospel. Jews in Jerusalem had Paul arrested and nearly killed. Well, during his incarceration, the Philippian church sent him generous gifts to help ease his suffering. Despite being confined, Paul's tone in Philippians is very upbeat and encouraging. In fact, the word joy or the verb rejoice, they appear repeatedly in this letter. What does Paul have to be so happy about? Let's see. Well, he's in prison. That's not good. There were preachers who didn't like Paul and they were glad he was in prison. That's not good either. Oh, and here's this. The Philippian church was being persecuted. So why did Paul talk so much about joy in the Lord? You know the answer to that. Because despite all the bad things that happen to us in this life, we know that something far better awaits us. I want to suggest to you that while joy is most definitely an important concept in Philippians, it's not the main point. As you read today, I want you to see Paul's emphasis on humility and unity. Those qualities go hand in hand, don't they? In chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, Paul prays on behalf of the Philippians. Every one of Paul's 13 letters, with one exception, has a word of thanksgiving and or a prayer at this point. This prayer just happens to be my favorite, and so I'm going to read it with you. And it is my prayer that your love for one another may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. I love that beautiful little prayer. By the way, it anticipates what Paul plans on talking about in this letter, their love for one another and the pursuit of living for Jesus. In verses 12 through 26, Paul talks about how his imprisonment has had unforeseen benefits. The gospel, he says, is reaching places completely unexpected. By being in prison, the whole palace guard and members of Caesar's own household have heard about the gospel. Paul makes this beautiful statement in verse 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. It's interesting that Paul doesn't know for sure he'll be released by Caesar Nero or not. We know he is released, but at the time, Paul didn't. And his strong faith carries the day when he says, I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Do you have that same confidence and strong hope in your heart? It doesn't matter what happens to me. In my life or in my death, I will glorify Christ. That's powerful. For Paul, serving Jesus is part of a community effort. He expects them to work together. Listen to these verses near the end of chapter 1, the verses 27 and 28. Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you, and that's plural by the way, that you all are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind striving side by side for the faith of the gospel, and not frightened in anything by your opponents. In chapter 2, we have an incredible description of Jesus. Verses 5 through 11 are a poem describing the humility of Jesus while on earth and his subsequent exaltation by means of his resurrection and ascension. Every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. After challenging the Philippians to follow Jesus' example of humility and service to others, he provides two examples, Timothy and Epaphroditus. Now, he doesn't identify them as examples of humility, but it's quite apparent from his description of them. They are imitating Jesus in their lives and actions. Timothy is Paul's preaching companion who will be genuinely concerned for your welfare, he says. That description epitomizes selfless service. And then this fellow named Epaphroditus, he risked his life by bringing the gifts from the Philippians to Paul. He got sick and nearly died. You know, this reminds me of Jesus, who did die in service to others. And then Paul provides a third example of selfless service and dedication to the Lord, himself. In chapter 3, Paul says he sacrificed everything that he held important and threw it away in order to gain Christ. And even after doing that, he still presses on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Listen to these words in chapter 3, verse 17, as Paul summarizes what he's been saying thus far. Brothers and sisters, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us. Jesus is the ultimate example, and people like Timothy, Epaphroditus, and Paul are following in his footsteps. What about you? Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. And then, suddenly, in chapter 4, verse 2, Paul brings up a major conflict between two Christian women in the church there. They're at odds with each other, Euodia and Syntyche. So far, there really haven't been any major issues at Philippi. And now, all of a sudden, at this point, here it is. These two women, who used to be marching side by side for the gospel, are at each other's throats, as it were. You know what I think? This letter was more than just a thank you note. It was a subtle way for Paul to emphasize the need for love and humility and unity, and to wake up everyone in this church who's pick sides and are fighting with each other. If that's true, then Paul went about it in a kind of sneaky way, didn't he? Talking about Jesus and selfless service and unity throughout this letter, and then mentioning this major conflict right near the end. You think that was on purpose? I do. I think that's exactly what Paul has done in this letter. See what you think. Please read all of Paul's letter to the Philippians in one sitting today. It should take you less than 20 minutes to read.